my social media presence was just okay. That has definitely changed since I started working with Five Stone.
I think I can safely say that our speaker is everybody's favorite historian. And by extension, I can say he's the Hammond Kiwanis Club's favorite historian, because about every 2 years or so, we invite Sam Hyde to come, and everybody's always excited about his coming. Look at the crowd today, and you can see that what I say is true. Dr. Sam Hyde is the director for the Center for Southeast Louisiana Studies at Southeastern. And if you have never been there, take the time sometimes to go up there. I recently had occasion to visit there, and they were getting ready for observance of the anniversary of World War I, and you might tell us a little bit about that, quite elaborate. It's a real treasure house of local history. Sam is also the Leon Ford Professor of History. It's an endowed chair at Southeastern, quite an honor. He's been extremely active in the Southeast Louisiana Historical Society, of which I am a member, and every year I look forward to our annual meeting. As Pat said, Sam wrote two books that are very noteworthy for this area: Pistols and Politics, one, which covered that subject matter, and not satisfied with telling the whole story about those turbulent years in the history of our parish, last year he published a second book, Pistols and Politics, that carried the story forward. I've read both books and thoroughly enjoyed both of them, and I highly recommend them. He's also written 9 other books, so obviously he's very busy. The story about our region is quite impressive, especially the story of the West Florida Republic, and Sam is an expert on that. And I don't know if you remember this or not, but I will tell this. A number of years ago, I heard Sam say that I think Governor Foster called some historians in and said, okay, what are y'all gonna do among the historians, Sam was there, what are y'all gonna do in Hammond for the 200th anniversary of the Louisiana Purchase? And Sam said, Governor, nothing. And to his chagrin, he goes, what do you mean nothing? He said, because we are not part of the Louisiana Purchase. And you can win a beer on that. You can say, is Hammond part of the Louisiana Purchase? No, it's not. Baton Rouge is not either, our capital. But anyway, Sam, of course, is incredibly knowledgeable about the history of our region. He was a Fulbright scholar and a Rotary scholarship scholar. He has studied widely, written widely, but above all, his heart remains right here in his native Tangipahoa Parish. Join with me in giving a big welcome to our speaker, Dr. Sam Hyde.
Well, what an exciting time to be from Tangipahoa Parish, huh? What is this? This is our sesquicentennial year, right? Everybody say that once, sesquicentennial. Okay, our parish president does not like that word. He wants us to go by the buck 50 year. He thought it was better, easier to say. But that's what it is. It's our 150th year. And so they asked me to come today, talk a little history, which I'm going to do a very little bit of that, and then tell you kind of what we're planning, okay? Well, what do we need to remember about this history when we think about all the folks that came and located here? It wasn't empty when they got here, right? And does anybody in this group know who was here first?
Among Native Americans.
Native Americans, but which ones? We got to be more specific than that. Most of us go to the Choctaw. That's the answer I would expect. They were the third group. After the Mississippian period, there was an even more vibrant group called the Petite Nations. Now, these were Muscogean peoples. You may have heard of them. They're the Bayou Gula, the Akola Pisa, and stuff like that. They concentrated along the mouths of the rivers and everything. And right here, there was a small tribe called the Tangipahoans. Now, how many of you have heard some of the controversy going on? Well, we all grew up thinking, did you not, that Ponchatoula was an Indian word, that Tangipahoa is an Indian word, that Amite, et cetera, other things like that are all Indian words. The point is, we're not sure. I had somebody from a national media outlet contact me recently and say, which is correct, which is the pronunciation? And I said, we will never know. And why not? because the Native Americans did not leave a written language, and therefore we don't know how they pronounced words like that. It's all subject to conjecture on our parts. And my know-it-all son, who's about to graduate from law school and change the world and everything, asked me, "Dad, you've been boring people for a living for so long. Why do we need to know all that crap?" And I explained to him that, well, the Native Americans were eradicated in their way of life, forced onto reservations and everything, and it wasn't just because of strength of numbers or technology. More so than anything, it was because they did not have a written history. They didn't know how they had dealt with the problems of the past. And he stood there and looked at me for a minute and went, "You know, that makes sense. Maybe some of what you're doing does make some sense." So it's important for us to study our history, especially here in a place that's known internationally to this day as Bloody Tangipahoa, because we have had a dark chapter in our history, darker than any other place in the United States that we have been able to identify, but we have some exciting things going on that are remarkable. So what happened? How do we know where those Native Americans live? How do you find them? You look for the middens, right? You know, the mussel shell mounds and everything, and that's what they lived off. It sustained them. But what else did they eat most of the time? We find some other things. And one of the things that's an exciting find for us, and we found another one recently, was a small metal pot. And though you always hear about the Native Americans wanting to trade for things like whiskey and guns and things like that, a little metal pot was more important to them than anything else they could trade for. And the reason being is because their primary sustenance, their primary food source, was something called sagamite. Are you familiar with what sagamite is? Sagamite was basically raw corn that they tried to ground up as best they could, and then they would throw in peas, beans, anything else like that that they had, and they did not have the clay pots that they had. You could not boil water in. So what they did is they would stretch out a deer skin, they would put water in it, they would put the corn and beans, whatever they had in there, and then they would heat up clay balls. Some of you may have seen these clay balls, found them at Native American sites and stuff. They would heat them up, put them into the water in the stretched out deer skin, and it would get kind of a tepid heat, and they would stir it up, so then they would eat that gritty, grimy sagamite, which was very hard. An elderly person or a small child, imagine the trouble they would have had eating that. It was very nutrition poor. Then imagine what it meant to them when a French explorer showed up and had a little metal pot that they could boil water in and turn that rough, coarse sagamite into creamy grits, the nutrition and things like that. So it was a issue of survival for them. Well, Bayou Jasmine and other sites down there, you know, near right at Manchac area right down there, have given us some of the most impressive finds of Native artifacts that we are constantly asked to loan them out. In fact, some of the fibrous finds, one guy told me, contacted me from Northern Illinois University, and he was saying, "We know of only two other places in the country that have anything like this." So there was a very rich culture. We began that way. Then the early antebellum area came, and this place kind of languished. There were no large population centers here, and there was a big reason for that, because after the British period, where there was very little development, does anybody know who was here first, though? French. French, then British, then Spanish. That's right, Iberville, yeah, right. But the French didn't do really anything. The British did a little bit around St. Francisville and Baton Rouge and that and everything. But then the Spanish came and they did something that put a legacy on this area. They saw it as a buffer zone and they wanted to populate it with as many people as they could. So everybody that was hostile to the Americans, they welcomed in. Now that included people that they gave 640-acre land grants to. My own family came and got a couple of those and everything. Some of you, rest of you, can trace your own holdings back to that too. They also charged no taxes, and they made it clear they weren't going to mess with you. Imagine how good life was back in that time. In fact, I think we ought to run a candidate on the Spanish policy today, and I guarantee you in Tangipahoa Parish they would win outright, okay? But they did something else. They also encouraged numbers, so they allowed desperados, army deserters from three different armies to concentrate here, and there were problems. And they had no police force, as we understand it, kept a dozen troops at St. Francisville, two dozen at Baton Rouge, and occasionally six at Springfield. Otherwise, there was no governmental authority either. So you can imagine the problems that began to develop. These deserters, the desperados, preyed on the market trails that crossed here. Because if you know anything about colonial trails and everything, the Natchez Trace, they would come down. If you had resources resources and money, you could put together a raft, you know, they, you know, the log boats that they would float down on and everything to New Orleans. If not, you were almost always coming right across here and going to Madisonville, to Port Vincent, to Springfield, one of those places where the market trails ended, and you crossed the lakes over to New Orleans. The Spanish did something else that's going to create problems and contribute to that bloody Tangipahoa legacy too, and that was they gave big land grants that were then, during the West Florida Revolt, abrogated. And so what you had was your neighbor had a French land grant, his neighbor had a British land grant, you have a Spanish land grant, and the new guy that just moved in has an American land grant. Which one do you honor? That wasn't a problem until 1852, 1854, when the railroad came through. And they put the governor on a train to show him just how fast they could get him into Mississippi. Train got 8 miles outside of New Orleans, hit a cow, and what happened, okay? Took the governor back, tried again 2 days later, got 14 miles outside of New Orleans, train hit a cow. Governor never got to Mississippi, but what did he do? He went back to the state capitol and said, what do we have to have? Fencing laws. And whereas you used to have a vague claim, oh, my land ends over there and my neighbor Tom's land begins somewhere around that knoll over there and everything, now we start putting fences down, and whose land grant are you going to honor? And that was one of the sources of the bloodbath that's going to incorporate this area later on. Well, as I said, 1852, 1854, everything changed here. Okay, the railroad came through, and it was a dramatic change. When they first came through, they found a little settlement at Independence. Anybody know what it was called then?
Uncle Sam.
Uncle Sam. That's right. It's called Uncle Sam. It was a little community. And there was a store with a couple of houses a little further north of there at a place called A Meat, which then they were writing A-M-E-E-T, okay? Which, and it, literally on postmarks, you can find that, which they meant the roads meet. That's where the roads meet. A meet right there, okay? But I was raised in Louisiana history being told it's a Choctaw Indian word for ear of corn. Did anybody ever hear that before? And then later I heard it's the Choctaw Indian word for big red ant. And then I heard that Ponchatoula was the Choctaw Indian word for beautiful long hair. I grew up understanding that Ponchatoula meant the Choctaw Indian word for very poor at sports, because we used to beat them every year, you know, when I was coming through, and we loved it. We'd rub it in their face. But the cotton economy arrived, and that changed things. No, hardly any communities, when they put that railroad through, they put water stops every 10 miles. And where was that first water stop? Ponchatoula. Where was the next one? Tickfaw. Not Hammond. That's a incorrect statement. Tickfaw. Next one, Ameet. And then the next one was at Tangipahoa, right? Okay. Yes, those were the original towns, and they boomed. The cotton economy, a Siamese black seed variety of cotton that would grow in the pine uplands, everything, revolutionized the economy, and the region took off. Then something happened, and it's called the Civil War. And it did not go well down here, okay, because it was as bad as it got. And they destroyed the railroad, there was no Marshall Plan for the defeated South. Black people who were finally free were never given the 40 acres and a mule they were promised and everything. Basically, Washington turned its back on the South and said, you started all this, now you solve it on your own. So it was a very hard time. But there swooped in the aftermath of it, a group called the Carpetbaggers, right? And they had some local allies called, derisively, scalawags. And one of them was a man named H.H. Bankston. Now, he's quite a colorful figure. There was some from down in this area, too, including someone named Johnson Yerkes, who came from Vermont, promptly had himself appointed commissioner of education, and he looted all the funds, went back, spent them, built himself a nice house, came back 2 years later, got himself appointed commissioner of education, looted all the funds again, and went back and bought his wife a brand new mink coat with everything and bragged about it for the rest of his life. One of his confederates was H.H. Bankston. Well, he was under multiple indictments for fraud and misappropriation of municipal funds. He got appointed mayor of Amy. And then he ran for sheriff in St. Helena Parish, and he didn't win. And like a good Louisiana politician, he refused to accept the results of that race. He went to New Orleans, set in with the carpetbag, as they called it, legislature there, and along with a man named Marshall Harvey Twitchell from New England, they got several new parishes created. And Bankston determined to get those people, those damn rebs who had treated him so bad, he made sure that that new parish that he was so interested in got carved right along the railroad, okay? So they cut the economic heart out of St. Lena, Washington, St. Tammany, and Livingston parishes, and made it Tangipahoa, and named it for the river which it was built around. And of course, in the aftermath, they did what? They began to encourage northern families to come down here and take advantage of these untapped virgin yellow pine forests. And they would come in droves. And in the process, they did what? They created towns like what? Like Hammond, like Roseland, like Kentwood. And these are the next tier of towns. And I've heard stories from the old guys and listened to oral history tapes and everything that their grandfathers had told them rivalries, you know, between the Yankee towns and the old established towns and everything, and that was the basis of a lot of the early football and basketball rivalry and things like that. But it created a great deal of diversity in this area, created a great deal of economic stimulus. What are some of the additions in Hammond right here called? Like the Iowa edition, you know, that was to encourage people to come down from those areas, you know, and C.E. Kate, who was running a shoe factory right here at Hammond during the Civil War and everything, he began inviting all his friends to come from New England and other places. Now, the introduction of those Northerners, though, is going to be another part of the bloody Tangipahoa troubles. And most of you are familiar with all this, but just I'm not going to get into that today. That's a whole nother lecture. But if you have a sense, if you do not have the sense of what we're talking about, if you've heard of the great Hatfield-McCoy feud, there were 12 murders in 12 years, and at least some of the perpetrators were brought to justice. Here, in the same, precisely same 12-year period, there were 133 feud-related murders, and hardly anyone was ever successfully prosecuted for the crimes. Just last February 2018, the Uniform Crime Report that came out from the FBI for the 26th year in a row, we were listed as the highest rural homicide rate anywhere in America. Now, we're used to it. It's our history. It's part of what we all know. We're not as shocked by these crimes and everything. I was speaking up in New England some months back and everything, happened to mention the three murders that occurred over the preceding weekend. And the first question was, are you trying to say there were three murders in one weekend where you were? And they were like, we hadn't had three murders in the past 10 years up here and everything. And that, to us, that's nothing very surprising and everything. So there is that dark part of the history. Cotton collapsed, adding to the aggravation. Have you ever read about that? What comes and does cotton in? Prices are already dropping, but what finishes it off around here? The boll weevil. And look, they watched it march from Mexico, and each year it was progressing. I list how many miles it was, I don't remember, in the book and everything, and these frantic businessmen were offering $50,000 way back in the 19th century, unheard of sums, for anybody that could come up with a way to stop it. But sure enough, it crossed the Sabine River, marched right on in here, ended that, and therefore we had the arrival of strawberry farming and things like that, which weren't just important for the strawberries themselves. Box factories, refrigeration plants, canning things, everything like that, rose up around it as well. Then came dairy. And dairy farming, of course, led to things like the milk strike. How many of you remember hearing about that? A huge event where people said, you're not bringing any cheaper Mississippi milk in here, and they started stopping trains, which is a federal law, putting guns to people's heads and everything, and showing they meant business. So Tangipahoa has had this very off-color history, but look at us today. We're one of the fastest growing parishes in the state, okay, in a place where people used to didn't even want to ride a train through, because when you started getting up around, you may have heard the stories about Hyde, next stop Tangipahoa, and things like that. People would have to hide under the seats because people would come out on Saturday nights and just shoot at the trains as they went by. And now we've got people pouring in such numbers we can hardly keep up with infrastructure improvements, housing. It's changed so much. So we, the parish president and the parish council, has created a sesquicentennial commission, okay, to celebrate our 150th anniversary, and we're going to have some exciting things very quickly. The kickoff, the celebration, is going to be on March 6th, this coming March 6th, okay, at 6 o'clock at the Hammond Branch Library, where they'll be showing the film The First Detroit. Does anybody know what that is? Right here. Let's learn some history while this year goes on, okay? We were the first Detroit right here. There's going to be refreshments, cake, hopefully champagne, if I'm going to drive over here for it afterwards, after that. Then, on April 17th, Southeast Louisiana Historical Association meeting will be all dedicated to Tangipahoa history at the Levy Building right over there. Hammond is going to incorporate their celebration into the hot August night on August 23rd, so it's going to be a celebration of Tangipahoa this year's hot August night. And All the other towns, Kentwood, Amite, Independence, and everything, Amite's organizing a white linen night as part of its celebration and everything. They're all putting them together. We should have all the dates confirmed by Thursday of this week. Then on September 21st, and please make a mental note of this, is going to be the grand finale. We're going to put a big marker up outside the parish building in Amite. We're going to put a time capsule in there. We're asking people that have any particular aspects of history or the culture of this area that they're familiar with, we'd like you to come forward with it, because these things are large. You can get, you know, significant amounts of things in them. We want to plant that for people to know what we were like a century from now. We're going to have out at the Florida Parishes Arena a huge big festival celebration replete with booths telling the history of every community, music from every community. The folks from Tickfaw and Independence literally came up with some squash type vegetable that I had never heard of, and it was so cool to be learning something new. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? That was it. Yeah, I still can't even pronounce that word, but that was it. They're going to do some dishes on that. So there'll be all that, and then we'll close out with fireworks, etc. We're also going to do one last thing. We're going to do something to leave a legacy out of this. We're going to try to put historic markers across the parish detailing every major event that we can identify and that we think is significant and should be included in this to create a tourism trail for Tangipahoa Parish, so that when people come here, hopefully we'll begin attracting buses out of New Orleans and others that come down the interstates to plug into. Because I go and speak at places like El Dorado, Arkansas, and they have 30,000 people show up, filling the hotel rooms, filling the restaurants, buying gas, everything else, because of one little feud shooting they had here. And when I think about it, we had more in 1 minute of 1 hour of one day than they had in their whole history, and we've never done anything to capitalize on it. We're not just going to be talking about the dark chapter of Tangipahoa Parish. We're going to be celebrating everything about it. We hope you'll join us. Thank you very much. They started construction in 1852. They intended to finish that year, but then early 1853, the big yellow fever epidemic hit, which decimated the laborers, killed three St. Lena sheriffs in a row and everything, and just stopped the work. So it wasn't finished until 1854. And it's soon after that that you begin seeing towns like Hammond and Roseland and Kentwood emerging right along that line, in the wake of the older establishments that were there right away before the war. The reconstruction is an impetus to the creation of towns like this. And let me tell you what, the other towns, like up in Amite and other places like that, they were howling that Hammond was getting preferred treatment and everything. Why? Because the railroad favored this, and it had so many Northerners backing it, and the railroad, of course, was Northern-owned too. And a town like Amite tried to demand that each train stop in Amy, so they didn't like that trouble they were giving them and everything. So it was a big boost for towns like Hammond. Yes, the misengineering of I-55. Well, there's a lot of stories connected with that, and even just the whole notion of creating roads, how poorly they were done. Some were done with convict labor, other were done. And look, listen at this. What they used to do was forced labor. You were required. You got a letter telling you you will show up on this day at this time to work all day on the road, bring one spade with you. Would you substitute that today for paying taxes? Now think about it. I asked my classes that and everything. But you mentioned I-55. All the towns up north up there, again, Kentwood, Amy, places like that, they thought it would be a boom for them. And it was an unmitigated disaster for them. Why? Because once I-55 came through, they could get on that interstate and get to Baton Rouge, New Orleans, or Hammond so much quicker. And soon, Kentwood, Amy, Independence were ghost towns. And one person told me, you know, it was within 2 years of the interstate coming through, you could not buy a men's shirt in Amite. All the old stores, some of y'all might remember B. Stearns, Sam Ball's, all those. B. Stearns was the largest department store in the Florida parishes, and I-55 killed it.
You know how most folks struggle to pay for clean fun in the summer? That kind of gets kids outdoors and having fun like the good old days. Well, this summer, we're going to give away over 2 dozen bikes for the third year in a row. It's going to be a great time. You can check it out at bikesforkidsla.com and enter there. We're trying to help kids that are doing good things in the community, good things in their churches and their school and elsewhere. So to try to get your kid a free bike this summer, check out bikesforkidsla.com.